Okay, the march is starting right now, and it's 1:32 p.m. Here it is. Okay, January 23rd, Saturday, 1:32 p.m.
Thank you. bad, Doug. Hey, you watch yourself.
Hey, this is a part of my story.
Watch out, you have
Still
waiting. No, it's already started to push
my dog. Take your picture.
That's good.
She wants her picture taken right here.
Make sure they
will be in the Statesman tomorrow.
No.
That's right.
Okay, they were.
I know. I was way up there.
So did she go?
go to the restroom. I think she went to look for you.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, oh, there you are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Listen, I've already been to the Capitol.
Hey, I got him. Y'all have to wait for me.
That's fine. Come on, babe.
Okay, don't go too far. Let me get you.
Yeah.
Well, I've been walking the whole. I'm trying to get the. I think the battery went dead, so I don't. Tell me, tell me if you think it did. I never used it, but it could be that it was sitting dormant for a while. I did get a lot of good footage though of the Mars. Yes. Yeah, this one. Is it dead? I can't. It's probably not something.
Legal throughout all 9 months of pregnancy. In the wake of Roe, legal abortion in our nation has claimed the lives of more than 57 million unborn children and has hurt countless women and men and has had a tremendous ripple effect across our country. Today we are here to also celebrate life. And praise God for the amazing gift of life that He gives us. Right now, I would like you to join me in thanking our incredible musicians, the Levi's fans. I'd like to introduce you now, Most Reverend Joe Vasquez, Bishop of the Catholic Diocese of Austin, for our invocation.
present this afternoon in this magnificent day in Central Texas as the Bishop of the Diocese and also on behalf of the Auxiliary Bishop Garcia, I thank you for your presence, especially to the young people. Thank you so much for coming out and witnessing to the beauty and preciousness of human life. Thank you. Let us now join ourselves in prayer. On this, the 43rd anniversary of the Supreme Court decision, Roe versus Wade, to legalize abortion, we are united as brothers and sisters in prayer. Life, O Lord, is your gift to us, and the Supreme Court's decision prevents the law from protecting the most vulnerable in our society, the unborn. We know that this precious gift of life is sometimes discarded, abused, and even destroyed. O God, the Father of every good gift, today we are here to pray and promote a greater appreciation for life in all its stages, from conception until natural death. Give us the grace needed to strengthen the culture of life and bring an end to abortion and the abuse of human life. We pray for conversion of hearts of all who perform or support abortion, that their hearts be open to the gospel of life. We ask that in your mercy you bring peace and healing to all those whose hearts are weighed down by the sin of abortion. May we grow in our conviction that human life is sacred from you, that is to be protected and cherished, so that the dignity of every person will be respected and valued. May your Holy Spirit, the giver of all life, sustain us and increase profound dignity for every human life. As always, we make this prayer in the name of Jesus, your Son, our Lord, who lives forever and ever.
Amen.
Amazing crowd. Thank you all for being here today. And it is just amazing that all of you have come to your Capitol to reaffirm your commitment and remind all of Texas that the Lone Star State is a pro-life state. Governor and Mrs. Abbott are very sorry that they couldn't be with you today. I know that he and Mrs. Abbott have both spoken to the rally in the past, but they were unable to be here today. But they definitely didn't want to miss out on the opportunity to send their greetings. And so I have a letter from Governor Abbott that I'm going to read to you. Greetings. As Governor of Texas, it is my honor to welcome everyone attending the Texas Rally for Life. To begin, I want to thank you all for being here. Our state stands at the forefront of the campaign to preserve the sanctity of life. And what better picture of this commitment than Texans gathered at their state capitol to demand the protection of the most vulnerable among us. I also want to thank Texas Alliance for Life, today's sponsors and leaders at the local, state, and federal levels who are working every day to put an end to abortion. Together, we can seek to change minds, advance loving alternatives to abortion, such as adoption, and defend the unborn against the tragedy that is Roe v. Wade. I am proud of the steps Texas has taken to promote a culture of life. As Attorney General, I defended Texas laws that preserve the rights of the unborn, including House Bill 2, which bans abortions after 20 weeks. Holds abortion clinics to the same standards of cleanliness and safety as other surgical facilities, and requires abortion doctors to have admitting privileges at hospitals. HB 2 is being challenged at the U.S. Supreme Court, but we are hopeful and prayerful that the justices will agree with Texas that this law protecting women and their unborn babies is fully constitutional. As governor, I have continued the fight for the sanctity of life. Here at the Capitol, we have been busy working on your behalf to ensure that the Lone Star State is doing everything possible to promote life and help those facing difficult decisions. In the most recent legislative session, I was proud to sign a budget increasing the funding of the Alternatives to Abortion program by more than 78% to $18 million. This new funding will allow Texas to support even more pregnant women who choose life for their babies. I also worked with the legislature to better protect pregnant girls from exploitation in the judicial system. Last year, Planned Parenthood once again proved why they embody the evil of abortion. Undercover videos exposed their barbaric and gruesome practice of harvesting and selling baby body parts. Like you, I was appalled and outraged. Texas immediately launched investigations into this horrific practice, and we are determined to bring this offense against humanity to an end in the Lone Star State. In the wake of those videos, I launched my Life Initiative. This initiative has four components. First, laws must be changed in Texas to make it a felony to perform a partial birth abortion and make it illegal for abortion doctors to risk a woman's health by altering the procedure to preserve fetal body parts. Second, Texas must improve and expand the availability of adoption services and increase awareness about Texas child support enforcement program, so that young mothers considering how to deal with pregnancy know the father will be held accountable to support his family. Third, funding of Planned Parenthood in Texas must be completely stamped out at once and for all. And fourth, we must eliminate and criminalize any sale or transaction of fetal tissue by an abortion clinic for any purpose whatsoever. These goals and the protection of life are particularly important to me on a personal level. As many of you know, Cecilia and I are adoptive parents. We were there when Audrey's birth mother made the decision to have her baby. We went to every doctor's appointment and were there at the hospital the day she was born. We have experienced firsthand the outcome of this life-changing process, and that makes protecting life all the more important to us. If that courageous woman had not chosen life, we would never have known our daughter, whom we cherish more than words can express. Adoption saves lives and gives families new opportunities to share their love. Once again, I want to thank you all for being here. Your presence sends a strong message that Texas values life, and it gives renewed courage that together and by God's grace, we can give every child the chance to live a happy and fulfilling life. God bless you all, and may God bless Texas. Sincerely, Governor Brandon.
Let's give one more hand for our amazing pro-life Governor Greg Abbott. Thank you so much for being here with us today, Ben, on behalf of the Governor and First Lady. Now I have the pleasure of introducing to you Texas State Senator Donna Campbell.
Dr. Donna Campbell is a board-certified emergency room physician and proud parent of four daughters. She lives in New Braunfels and represents Senate District 25, a six-county district which includes parts of San Antonio and Austin. Among the awards she has received is the Courageous Defense of Life Award from Texas Alliance for Life. Her devotion to life and to adoption is well known in the Capitol, as are her qualities of fearlessness and tenacity. She is a great friend to have, but pity her enemies. Last spring, in the debate for HB 416, a bill she sponsored to protect victims of human trafficking at abortion facilities, Senator Campbell spoke with the credibility that only a pro-life physician has and totally defeated the bill's opponents. Please join me in welcoming Senator Donna Campbell.
Beautiful, beautiful afternoon. Can you all hear me? Think about it. Hope, life, love, right, fight, liberty, freedom, work, wholeness. Do these words conjure a vision of what America is meant to be? Yes, they do. I want to thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Poyman, for having me here, Texas Alliance for Life. Thanks to each and every one of you for being here today, standing for life, and marching for life. We do have an undoubtedly the strongest leadership in our legislature today for pro-life, with our great Governor Greg Abbott and our Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick. As I said, I'm a mother of four. I'm a mother that has adopted four girls. I've got my youngest with me here, Annabeth. And if that's not an example of the life that God gives us that we need to protect, I don't know what is. Family and our faith who makes us who we are as a nation and as a people. America has led, Texas has led, because we have followed our principles and walked in faith. We've honored the sacred value of life from conception and promoted the family unit, mother, father, and child. No doubt this has made us a better nation and a better people, wouldn't you agree? Yeah. And look at those among us today. We are not divided by denominations. We are not divided by color or by gender. We are standing for an issue that should be bipartisan because we are standing for life. The men in front that you see, they are from the Knights of Columbus. They stand for life. And everything they do, it's not partisan, it is life. And I thank them so much for the work that they do across our state. You know, our values, it's easy to see, our values are under attack. But we must remain more committed than ever to stand on our principles and fight for life, right? You wouldn't think you'd have to fight for life, but there's such a great fight to kill that we have to stand and be strong, right? This past session, there were five major pro-life bills, and I was proud to sponsor House Bill 416 to protect victims of sex trafficking whenever they were at abortion facilities, to train those that work at abortion facilities to spot victims that might be having an abortion out of coercion, You wouldn't think that would have taken a fight, would you? But that's just an example of what's happening to our culture today. But it took a fight, but we were successful. And why were we successful? Because the blessing of perseverance is success. Let me hear you say that. The blessing of perseverance is success. I was the one who found the third point of order against Wendy Davis's filibuster. And you know, while she stood a few hours on the floor, we have stood much, much longer, years standing for life, innocent life. What a great moral victory for Texas to win that. You know, together we passed pro-life legislation. House Bill 2 that we've heard us talk about is proof that the disastrous repercussions of Roe v. Wade and the millions of innocent lives that have been lost since that decision, despite that decision, we can still be successful in stopping abortions and saving innocent lives. And who is on our side? The Almighty Lord above. That bill was supported by current medicine and by science of the 21st century. As a result, facilities, even though we want to shut them down, the facilities are at least to be safer for women. We've got to continue our work, and we have to protect our most tiniest, our most valuable little Texans and their right enshrined in law. You know, let me talk a little bit about that bill. There's a portion of this bill, and thanks to you, it was all passed, and others like you. But it's now being challenged at the United States Supreme Court. And, you know, yes, we'd like to see abortions stop, but we want to at least make sure the place that a woman gets an abortion, and that the person doing the abortion is as safe as can be. Wouldn't that make sense? And that we would expect the facility to at least be of the standards of an ambulatory surgery center like you would go to for any outpatient surgery, right? Currently, there are many abortions done in a facility that is at risk for infections. They are not clean like ambulatory surgery centers. You can't even mobilize an ambulance stretcher if you needed to in an emergency. But this talk that they have accuses us of decreasing access. And I say, no, it increases safety, right? Are they really wanting to scrap the safety of a procedure, safety for women, in order to get access? I mean, that's a back alley, that's access. We are trying to at least give safety for women. That should not be bipartisan. That is the general welfare. To ask a doctor to have privileges at a hospital where they can fix any emergencies, is that asking too much? Yet that is what the Supreme Court will hear, and we need to pray that the Supreme Court will do the right thing for the general welfare and for women. Yesterday, and I don't know how many of you heard it, there was a Democrat on television talking about House of Representatives out of D.C. talking about the bill was just a ruse to shut down clinics and to prevent women from getting the health care they deserve. Let me tell you something, there's nothing about abortion that is health, right?
No.
This is about safety. It should be bipartisan. It's not about health care. Abortion is not about health care. It's about killing. Obama said, he vows to protect, and I quote, "In America, every single one of us deserves the rights, the freedoms, the opportunities to fulfill our dreams." Is he talking about humans with a unique DNA? Does he not know that babies in the womb have a unique DNA. They are human. They deserve the right, the freedom, and the opportunity to fulfill their dreams that they will have. Where does he define life starting? Just arbitrarily where he wants it to start? We have to pray that the Supreme Court will do due diligence and uphold our law. Your actions, let me tell you about your actions here today, united in strength, in numbers. Whenever we have bills in the legislature and we need your help, you need to be here. Your voice, look at the difference your voice can make. You can call your representative, call your senators, and be here. You can affect law in Texas and keep Texas strong. Your efforts will protect babies in the future, and this may be one step at a time, but the blessing of perseverance is
success.
That's exactly right. You know, the Lord tells us, Psalms 139, I knew you when you were formed in the womb and wonderfully made in his image, right? How can we destroy that? What God creates, man had better not destroy. With the help of our governor and lieutenant governor, we've got a conservative majority, at least in the Senate. We will stop the sale of babies and baby parts. Yeah. Do you agree that we must keep Texas safe and pro-life? Yeah. We have got to keep Texas strong. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And why do we have to keep Texas strong? Because, folks, we don't have another Texas to move to. Thank you. Got to love that fire and Dr. Campbell. Let's give her another round of applause. Woo! Now, we are a nation of technology and social media now and all that fun stuff, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. So remember today that when you're posting your pictures, use hashtag TXRallyForLife. TX Rally, the number four life, and let's show the world that Texas is pro-life today and beyond. So don't forget that. And now I have the pleasure of introducing to you Dr. Joe Poyman. Dr. Poyman has been lobbying for pro-life laws in the Capitol before you for more than 28 years. He is the founder and executive director of Texas Alliance for Life. Please welcome Dr. Joe Poyman.
Wow, I don't know the last time I saw so many beautiful Texans here. Thank you all for being here. Well, we asked for 59 degrees. The Lord sent us 60 degrees. I don't think we're complaining. I want to recognize several dignitaries here, members of the legislature who are getting things done, from State Representative from Georgetown, Representative Marsha Farney. State Representative from Van, Texas, Representative Dan Flynn, and a colonel in the Texas State Guard. He was here as an exercise. State Representative Paul Workman from Spicewood. How many people live in Representative Workman's district? And of course, Senator Campbell. As you marched up Congress Avenue, I know you could not help but notice the beauty and power of our Capitol building with its graceful dome and massive granite stones. On the second floor is the governor's office, and that's where bills are signed into law. Last session was a sensational session for the pro-life movement in Texas. and Governor Abbott signed into law five huge pro-life measures, each of which makes us the envy of any other state. Protected unborn children with Down syndrome. Protected minor girls from abortion by closing loopholes in that judicial bypass process. Protecting women from sex trafficking at abortion facilities. Reformed end-of-life laws to increase protection for vulnerable patients, protecting them from euthanasia. Promoting adult, not embryonic, stem cell research and treatments. And the governor signed a budget that shifted another $1.3 million from Planned Parenthood to better providers for services for low-income women.
Yay!
You know, just a couple days ago, Americans United for Life, based in Washington, D.C., they did a survey of all the states, what we accomplished in 2015. And you know, they found Texas ranked in the top three in the entire nation. Congratulations. In fact, they're calling us a lifeless all-star. We need to thank Governor Abbott, Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick in the Senate, and Speaker Joe Strauss in the House, all pro-life. So much of these victories are possible because of our leadership and the members, and because of you here exercising your free speech. We're here to speak for those who cannot speak for themselves. And we know our free speech right is not free, and we all know that many have lost their lives for our right to be here to speak for those who cannot speak for themselves. I want you to exercise your free speech by signing this petition against coerced abortions. This is so helpful for us to show the members of the legislature that Texas will not stand for coerced abortions, for women being forced into abortions against their wishes. And even the cost of this rally is not free. The march permit with the city of Austin, and even the permits for the states, in total cost thousands of dollars. So there's a way you can help. When you leave the Capitol grounds, please put a donation in one of these red bags. Let's say donation. There will people be off site. You can also go on your phone, and you can go to TexasAllianceForLife.org, and you can make a donation, if you wish, because we all need to work together on this. And most of all, as always, always, stand up and speak out for life. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Quayman. And I just have to say, I am so blessed, and I love, and I can speak for many leaders in town and across the state, that we are so blessed to have groups like Texas Alliance for Life on that legislative battle, fighting for the rights for unborn, for women and families. So thank you, Dr. Joe Quayman. And now I have the great pleasure of introducing to you our featured speaker for this afternoon. She hails visits from Kansas City today. So she came all the way from Kansas City to join us and be here with us today. And that is Melissa Oden. Melissa is the survivor of a failed abortion, a failed saline infusion abortion in 1977. Despite the initial concerns regarding Melissa's future after surviving the attempt to end her life at approximately 7 months gestation, she has not only survived, but she has thrived. With a master's degree in social work, she has worked in the fields of substance abuse, mental health, domestic violence, and sexual assault counseling, and child welfare. Melissa has been featured on television and radio programs, including The 700 Club, EWTN's Life on the Rock and Defending Life, Fox News, Focus on the Family, American Family Radio, and many, many more. In September of last year, you may have seen the video that went viral. Melissa Odin testified in front of the U.S. Congress. If you have not seen that video yet, you need to make sure when you go home today to YouTube Melissa Odin, U.S. Congress. It is incredibly powerful, but you get a great taste of her today. She's a dear friend of mine. Everyone, let's give a big Texas welcome to Melissa Odin.
You know, I finally decided what I'm going to be when I grow up. Donna Campbell. Thank you, Senator. I thought I knew before today, and suddenly now I really do know. Thank you. And thank you, every single one of you, for being here today. You know, before I get started, I do want to make sure we give Heather Gardner a round of applause for being a fantastic MC today. It's not easy to carry a crowd of a few thousand people, so Heather, thank you. You know, I was sitting here thinking about everything I plan to say to you all today, and I'll be very honest. Instead, I was sitting in my seat with a lump in my throat, and it's still here, and I'm trying to choke it back. Because in reality, I can go before Congress and tell them about what abortion has done in my life, and I can prepare the remarks of what I want to say to you all today. But for somebody like me, who was supposed to be one of those 57 million lives ended by abortion, I will tell you, I see you all here today, and it brings me to tears. Because I am here today only because ordinary people, just like you, stood up and fought for me. I am only here today because ordinary people, just like you, prayed outside of the hospital that I survived at, that someday a child's life would be spared from an abortion. And here I am. I am only here today because people were willing to love me when others thought that I was unlovable. And so I am here today to first of all say thank you. Thank you for doing everything that you do on behalf of lives like mine. And we all know the statistics, right? We know that not only have we lost 57 million lives like mine to abortion in the last 43 years since Roe versus Wade, but today alone, 3,000 children will lose their lives to abortion. 897 of those lives will be ended by Planned Parenthood. I am so thankful that Texas has led the way to strip funding to Planned Parenthood to the minuscule levels that it is, but that's still $2 million too many. And so know that even though I'm not in Texas, I am watching from afar and I am cheering all of you on. And I know many of you know a little bit about my life story. I will tell you more in a second about the type of abortion procedure I survived. But I am here today to first of all make it clear that I am so much more than a statistic. I'm standing here today as a wife, as a mother of two little girls, 7 years old and 17 months old. I'm standing here as a daughter, as a sister, as a master's level prepared social worker, and yes, as an abortion survivor. By the grace of God alone, right? Praise God. And I know that you will hear many things about people like me in this world. You know, I hear them a lot. From a botched abortion to the dreaded complication of an abortion, a child who lives. What a dreaded complication, right? I've been called just about everything you can imagine. But I hope that you can join with me today to simply say, I am blessed, and I am called to be a witness for life alongside all of you. And as Heather mentioned, I did testify before Congress this past fall in the hearings regarding Planned Parenthood, and I literally got to show them that day parts of my medical records. And you can see them still on my website, I believe, on the photos page of my website, Melissa Oden, OHDEN.com. You can see some of those snippets that I shared with Congress. They say things like, a saline infusion for an abortion was done, but was unsuccessful. Unsuccessful. In a world that wants to hide behind rhetoric and somehow call abortion a choice and a right, I think my medical records have it very right. I am only standing here today because an abortion failed to end my life successfully. That's the truth about abortion. Other parts of my medical records say things like, one of the complications of my biological mother's pregnancy was a saline infusion, abortion. I would say abortion complicates pregnancy. The truth is quite clear in my medical records. And, you know, to be honest, it's taken me many, many years to unravel the story of my survival, to have contact with my biological family and the medical professionals who cared for me. You know, I've been so blessed to meet some of them personally. But I know there's lots of still unanswered questions. But what I do know is that my life was intended to be ended by that saline infusion abortion. And even after I survived, sadly, my life was in jeopardy. You wouldn't know it by looking at me today, but in August of 1977, I survived that failed saline infusion abortion. And I know many of you can remember the saline infusion abortion from years past. It was the most routine procedure back in the 1970s. For those of you that aren't aware, that saline infusion abortion involved injecting a toxic salt solution into the amniotic fluid surrounding me in the womb. The intent of that toxic salt solution was to scald me to death from the outside in. You could read more about it online, but you'll read about how that procedure usually lasted about 72 hours. The child soaked in that toxic salt solution until their life was effectively snuffed out. And then premature labor was induced with the intent of a deceased child being delivered. What I know in my own life is that I didn't soak in that toxic salt solution for just 3 days. My medical records indicate that I soaked in it for five. 5 days I soaked in that toxic salt solution. And as horrific as it is that I fought for my life in the womb, I hope that you can agree with me that it was just as horrific for my birth mother to be subjected to that procedure over those 5 days. Just as horrific for her. On that 5th day of the abortion procedure, her premature labor was induced with me. She was a 19-year-old college student at the time that she delivered this child who was meant to be a successful abortion, a deceased child. You know, in 2013, I actually learned through contact with my biological mother's family that not only was this abortion forced upon her against her will, but also that it was my own grandmother, my maternal grandmother, who was a nurse, who forced it upon her and even delivered me in that final step of the abortion procedure at St. Luke's Hospital in Sioux City, Iowa. I know it's hard to wrap your head around this, right? It's like something out of a movie. This isn't something that should happen in our world, but it does happen. And I truly believe that what happened in my life is just a glimpse of what abortion has done in our society. When we know that we have lost tens of millions of lives to abortion, we have hundreds of millions of lives hurting. It isn't so far-fetched that a grandmother could force an abortion and then deliver her own grandchild in the final step of that procedure. You know, unfortunately, at that time, I also learned that when my grandmother delivered me in that final step of the procedure, she is the one that demanded that I be left there to die. And sadly, we know I am not the first nor the last child in our great country that that has happened to. But I want to be clear about something, though, about my grandmother and really about my entire biological family. I think we live in a world that expects me to hate them for what was done to me. I am here to tell you something very different. I love them. I love my grandmother, that abortionist, my biological parents. I love them no matter what decisions were made about my life, and I encourage you to love that way in return. We are a movement that isn't just pro-life or pro-child. We are pro-woman, and we are also pro-love. And that will change the world. And it changed my world. I can guarantee you that. You know, what I won't know is that how exactly two nurses who were on staff at that hospital found out about the secret abortion and the little girl who lived. They fought for me. They found out that I survived and was being left to die, and they fought for medical care to be provided to me that ultimately sustained my life. And I know what happened to children like me that survived abortions at that hospital. And you can hear more about it in my testimony before Congress. But really briefly, what I will tell you is that other children like me that survived abortions there were left to die in the utility closet. That utility closet was meant to be my fate, even after I fought for my life in the womb. What a tragedy we have come this far in our nation. And you would never know by looking at me today that when I first survived that abortion, I was fighting for my life. I weighed a little less than 3 pounds. I was a whopping 2 pounds, 14 ounces. I suffered from severe respiratory and liver problems. I suffered from seizures for an extended period of time. And the doctors made it clear. They didn't think that I would live for very long past my infancy. And if I did, I would likely suffer from multiple disabilities throughout my life, ranging from blindness and deafness to having emotional and mental disabilities. And I know when some people in our world hear things like that, they still want to somehow believe that maybe my life was one not worth saving. And maybe my life was not one that could ever be loved. But I am here on behalf of my adoptive parents to say, the doctors had it wrong. I was lovable. My adoptive parents opened their hearts and their home to me not long after they first met me in the neonatal intensive care unit. And in all honesty, I was very blessed to be loved by many doctors and nurses who believed in me and gave me a name when I was left nameless, knitted me clothing that I still have in my possession today. And yes, no matter what the doctor said about what my life was going to look like, I'm standing here today perfectly healthy. Thank you, Lord. But I know that we live in a world where you don't often hear about lives like mine. You know, it isn't often talked about how abortion ends the life of a child. And you may not know that there are lots of people like me in our world. I am the executive director of a group I founded called the Abortion Survivors Network. You can check us out at theabortionsurvivors.com. But what you'll figure out is we're your friend. We're your coworker, your neighbor, your family member. I know members of high ranking in politics federally who are survivors of abortion. I know prominent businessmen who are survivors of abortion. I know survivors who are 2 years old up to in their 60s and 70s. Through my work with the Abortion Survivors Network, I have now been blessed to know 207 other people just like me. What a blessing, right? What an amazing blessing. And I know that not every survivor is going to share their story like me, but I do truly believe that I am called to give a voice to those 57 million children who are voiceless, to give them a face. You know, I now have the great opportunity to turn to Congress and truly our world and say, this is what 57 million other lives would have looked like in some way, shape, or form if only they had been given the opportunity to live. This is what they would have looked like. And I may not have survived my birth mother's abortion at Planned Parenthood, but that will not stop me from talking about the evil of their practices. You know, I have long since believed that if my birth mother's abortion would have taken place at a Planned Parenthood and not a hospital, I truly believe that I would not be standing here today. They have become so effective at perfecting the very thing that was meant to end my life. I know that they would have made sure that I was not on these steps today. And as a fellow American, as a fellow human being, I deserve the same right to life, the same equal protection under the law as each and every one of you, right? But we live in a day and a time where those protections don't exist by and large. And we know that your tax dollars and mine are still going to an organization that has perfected that procedure that was meant to end my life. Can you all join me in saying, this must end. This must end. And it will end. You believe that, don't you? I believe it too. And it will end. And I know you know that Texas is paving the way for the rest of the nation when it comes to passing legislation that not only protects the lives of the unborn, but shows respect for the lives of women. Abortion is not health care. Amen? Women deserve to receive the health care that they need. And I am so thankful that the state of Texas is funding women's health care at a historic level, while at the same time, more abortion clinics are closing their doors. That's what empowerment of women actually looks like. That's what health care looks like. You know, Texas has so dramatically reduced Planned Parenthood's funding. Let's just all give that one more round of applause. I don't think we can cheer that on enough. And in closing, what I just want to say is I am so thankful for my life and for the lives of each and every one of you who have answered God's calling to be a voice for life and to fight for a culture of life to be restored. And I do truly believe each and every one of us have a calling. You know, I think most people look at me and go, woo, I could never do that. First of all, never say never. By the grace of God, all things do happen. But I know most of you may have a very different calling when it comes to this fight. Whether it's through the work at a pregnancy center, 40 Days for Life campaign, sidewalk counseling, post-abortion ministry, we are all called to fulfill that calling to defend and protect life. And so I am here today to first of all say thank you for doing that, but I want to encourage you to keep going. We cannot be complacent in this. And by the grace of God, with all of us continuing on this path, the culture of life will be restored and abortion, as we now know it, will end. Thank you so much for being here today.
Praise God. Oh my goodness. How powerful. You know, many times the last line of defense for the unborn child between the safety of the womb and the abortionist's instruments, as Melissa said, is the prayerful presence of peaceful, compassionate, pro-life citizens on the sidewalk. Our next speaker heads up the Houston Coalition for Life, which parks an ultrasound bus directly outside of not only an enormous Planned Parenthood abortion facility, but the largest abortion facility in the Western Hemisphere in Houston, Texas. I want you to join me in welcoming to the stage Director of Houston Coalition for Life, Christy Melcher. Woo!
Thank you, Heather. Thank you, Dr. Poyman. And Melissa, you're truly an inspiration to all of us. What an awesome crowd today. I have to give a special shout out right now to everyone here from Houston, Texas. The Houston Coalition for Life, like most of you, provides compassionate alternatives to abortion. We have dedicated people who get out of bed in the dark, in cold, in the heat, and come and stand and pray outside the darkest place on earth, the huge abortion facility called Planned Parenthood of the Gulf Coast. There's also trained sidewalk counselors who get out of bed before the crack of dawn and brave the cold and the heat, and come and offer kind, loving, and non-judgmental help to the women who are seeking services at this abortion facility. And I'm sure many of you out there right now are stand and pray warriors and sidewalk counselors. And if you are, please make yourself known. I bet there's even more of you than that. In February of 2011, as Heather alluded to, we started parking a mobile crisis pregnancy center that we call the Big Blue Bus, next to Planned Parenthood in Houston. In it, we offer free pregnancy tests, free ultrasounds, and Christian counseling to the women seeking abortions there. Thank you. You know, pro-lifers can always figure out a way to bring the love of Christ to the darkest place on earth, and even offer free services right there outside this abortion giant who can't seem to figure out how to do anything like this. Planned Parenthood, as you all know, is not about helping women. It's only about taking their money. Would you think that a 44-foot blue bus on a little side street in Houston would be very successful next to the biggest abortion facility in the Western Hemisphere? You're right, we are. We have had hundreds, even thousands of visits to our blue bus since we began in February of 2011. We have seen 9,630 visits to the bus, and over 90% of all the women that we have had the privilege to serve have chosen life for their unborn children. Of course, it's the grace of God that touches their hearts when we show them their unborn child on the big screen TV that is the monitor for our ultrasound machine. But it's also people like you, all of you out there today, because without you standing on the street in prayer and the offering of alternatives, we would not be successful. So your prayers and your work back home in all the cities that you came from today are so important, and I can't tell you how important it is that you continue to do this. Since we're down to 6 abortion facilities in Houston, we decided to become truly mobile, and we took the very innovative step of putting our second mobile crisis pregnancy center on the road, which we affectionately call Baby Blue. And we are taking it to one of the other facilities in town to offer real life-affirming solutions, anything a pregnant mom could need to be able to continue her pregnancy. Currently, we're also in the process of opening a freestanding crisis pregnancy center where we will offer learn-to-earn programs. We won't make any mom jump through any hoops to get what she needs, but we're going to offer her classes to enable her to become a better parent and a better woman and provide her with anything that she might need. But our ministries of stand and pray and sidewalk counseling will always be the most important thing that we do. Because until you have stood and prayed outside an abortion facility, nothing else can really mean the same to you. All pro-life work takes on a new meaning once you have stood and prayed outside an abortion facility. Would you all agree with me on that? Yeah. How many of you have stood and prayed outside an abortion facility? This year, we're very excited to be conducting our 20th 40 Days for Life campaign. We are so lucky to live in the greatest state in the nation with the pro-life laws that have been enacted here. It makes it so much easier for us to do the work that God has called us to do. And I want to ask God to bless you all on your way home today, and thank you for coming.
Thank you so much, Christine. We are about to have our closing benediction, but before we do, I want to make a plea to you to keep in mind everything that you have heard today, and to remind you that this cannot be your pro-life activity for the year. This has to be a renewal, a start, a next stepping stone. You cannot walk away from here and not do something to speak for the voiceless, to speak for the unborn, to speak for women who are vulnerable to abortion and are being attacked and targeted by the abortion industry. Everybody has a place in this movement. If you have no idea where to start, Google pro-life activity in whatever city you have, pro-life group. Google is amazing. It can help you find those things. But do something. You have the responsibility, we all have the responsibility to use the gifts and the talents that God has given us. You can inventory items in a pregnancy center. You can volunteer for an hour outside of an abortion facility a week. There's 40 Days for Life campaigns all across the country and the world that you can volunteer at. You can make a huge impact. And you know what? It's not just the women who choose life that tell us how important this is. It's the workers inside of these abortion facilities. I can say here locally, we have 9 abortion workers who have left and have conversions. And they speak more than anyone about the atrocities that are happening inside of these so-called safe clinics. Do something to be a voice for the voiceless. Do not let this be your pro-life activity for the day. Whether you are 8 or 80, you can do something, and I want to encourage you to do that. And now if you will please join me in welcoming Pastor Shedrick Rory from our local FX Community Church to give our benediction, and following we will have the Levites band sing God Bless America.
Amen, let us pray. God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and of earth, and of all things visible and invisible, we end our time today acknowledging you and affirming that you are where our help comes from. We pray for our unborn sisters and brothers in the tomb, in the womb, and in the fight that we're engaged in the world doesn't even compare to the fight that they're engaged in the womb. As they resist their attackers, assure them that there are a few people on this side of the womb doing what we can to bring about change. Lord, show us where we can even do more. Show us the areas where we can raise our voices even louder. Empower us to continue standing and advocating for you and for them. I pray that we won't leave our advocacy right here on the steps of the Capitol, but let us make it to, let us take them to our various places and residences, then spill over into the places of influence in our lives, in our conversations, in our timelines, in our newsfeed. Lord, be with the legislators as they make decisions. Guide them to make decisions that honor you. I pray that money would not be the deciding factor of who lives and who dies. For the earth is yours and the fullness thereof. And so we pray, God, for your resources. Would you fund and defund our efforts as you see fit with the resources that you've given us here on earth. And for every mother trying to decide whether they should keep or abort, I know it's not an easy decision, so God, I pray that you would be with them even in that time. Let them know that life is never a mistake, that human life has been your idea since the beginning of time. Let them experience your nearness even in that moment of decision. Let them know that you are provider, the giver, and sustainer of life. And I pray that we would steward that life well. It's in Jesus' name that I pray, and everyone say amen.
Amen. Abortion started here in Texas, and abortion will end in Texas. God bless you.